Happy Wednesday, everybody. This is Alan Arnette with another podcast on the blog on alanarnette.com. It is Wednesday, April the 6th, 2022. As we continue to take a look at what's happening over in Nepal, at all the 8,000 meter mountains, plus, of course, Mount Everest. You know, the season is turning out kind of as we expected. It's going to be slow this year. You know, if you look back last year, around early April right now, Nepal had issued 222 permits for 23 teams. This year is down to 138 on 16 teams. So, you know, roughly 100 less at this point. Now, there's still a long way to go. A lot of teams are still arriving. They're still going through the permitting process, but still, you know, at one point I was thinking around 300 climbers, foreign climbers. I'm thinking now it may be less, even less than that, maybe as low as 250. But we'll wait and see. You know, I think it's really good news for the mountain. You know, on the Chinese side, there's really been limited activity for the last 3 years. I think it's given a chance for, you know, people to come in and help to clean up the trash on the mountain on that side. There's been some of that on the Nepal side. There's several teams this year, including the Nepal Army, that's going to be trying to clean up some of the trash from the base camps on multiple 8,000 meter mountains and some other teams. You know, Asian Trekking has really been the leader in this for a long, long time, maybe a decade or longer, with their Eco Everest climbs, where they've done cash for trash, where they've paid people to bring down used oxygen bottles and things like that. So An Shearing and Dawa Stephen Sherpa and the team at Asian Trekking has really just been the role model for how to try to preserve their country and preserve the cleanliness of the mountains. So I applaud all the efforts that any team does in trying to help keep the mountains clean. So, you know, everybody's trekking through right now. I'm going to try to do a podcast with Garrett Madison of Madison Mountaineering. I'm going to try to reach him and get an update from him. He's over in the Khumbu right now. I think he's in Namche, if I'm not mistaken. But we'll get an update from him. And so right now, the entire Khumbu is filled with people just trekking in, not only trekking, but also going up to Everest Base Camp, of course, to give it an attempt. You know, looking at some of the pictures I've been watching and getting some emails from people that are trekking in right now, everybody talks about Ama Dablam. And, you know, if you haven't seen Ama Dablam, you know, take a look at it. I've got it here, a picture on this post for this podcast. But it brought back just very, very fond memories for me, because when I first saw Ama Dablam, number one, I said, it's impossible to climb. Nobody can climb that mountain. And I was told, no, people do climb it all the time. And I said, well, okay, maybe somebody else does, but not me. You know, this was back in 1997, on my first trek to Everest Base Camp. And, you know, I looked at Ama Dablam and I said, you know what? I don't have the skills. I don't have the time, the money. There's no way. So I'm just going to take a picture of it and that'll be good enough for me. Well, 3 years later, I stood on the summit of Ama Dablam. This kind of goes to show you that never say never, right? So, but being on that climb, looking at these pictures that I'm watching right now, just brings back such great, great, vivid memories. So I climbed with adventure consultants out of New Zealand, and David Hiddleston was the lead guide that year. And, you know, in that time back in 2000, we had one Sherpa with us, and sadly, I don't remember his name. And, but we carried all of our gear up to the mountain and set up the tents and, you know, pretty much did everything ourselves, unlike what a lot of the climbs are done today with tremendous Sherpa support by the tremendous Sherpas. So always grateful to the Sherpas and give a shout out to their hard work and the risk they take. But in 2000, you know, we were kind of out there on our own doing it. Small team, you know, did a couple of acclimatization rotations and eventually made our way up to the high camp right off underneath the famous Dablam. This time, most people climb from about camp two, but in those times you went all the way up to camp three. So we took off that night, got up really early in the morning as normal, and took off to go try to get to the summit. And I got to tell you, it's one of the best memories I have in all of my mountain climbing. And, you know, of course, I'm very proud of Everest and K2 and other climbs, but Ama always stands out for a very unique reason. I think one of it is that I didn't think I could do it. and I did it. But that summit night is just etched in my memory. I remember leaving the tent, and climbing with headlamps on, just kind of heading up. It's very steep, probably very steep. It's about 50 degree angle, which is steep for mountains, leaving the high camp. And the snow was pretty hard packed. It was cold. I just remember being so, so cold. And actually, I was in my down suit that I'd worn on Choi U a couple of years earlier. And so that experience on Choi U taught me a lot. I reached 8,000 meters of summit plateau, but I didn't quite reach the tippy top. And so I was a little nervous and apprehensive leaving the tent that night, heading up for the summit of Ama Dablam. Took one step at a time, ice axe, just kind of going along. There was no fixed rope either. I remember that. I remember just kind of walking, you're really climbing on your own. It's true climbing. So we're going along and just, reaching, step by step higher and higher, feeling the altitude now and just get into wonder, can I really do this or not? But you know what? I was making good time and I felt confident. And that mental part, that confidence is one of the things that sticks in my mind. And so I got about, maybe 2/3 of the way up the slope. And I turned around, looked over my shoulder because I was leading the group. Can you believe that? Can you believe that this guy was leading the group on Ama Dablam? So I couldn't. So I turned around, I looked over my shoulder to make sure that I wasn't alone. And there was David Hiddleston back down behind me. And he looked up and he pointed to up ahead and he yelled out, "Summit!" And I just looked at him, my big old grin, big thumbs up. And I kept going. And before you know it, I couldn't go any higher. I remember standing on the summit of Ama Dablam, I was just spellbound. I was just gobsmacked. I looked off one direction. There's Makalu, one of the world's greatest 8,000 meter mountains, and one that was always on my list, but I'll probably never get a chance to climb Makalu. But I looked the other direction, and there she was, Mount Everest. I'd seen Everest from the summit of Kalapatar on my trek in 1997, and it was awe-inspiring then. But to be able to see it from the summit of Ama Dablam was just spellbounding. I mean, it was huge. It was massive. I could see the plume coming off. I could just see the giant shape of the mountain. It was just amazing. I looked at it with awe, and I thought to myself, wow, you are so lucky to be able to see the mountain from the summit of Ama Dablam, but you'll never do it. I felt the same way about Everest that I felt about climbing Ama Dablam. I didn't have the skills, time, money, no way. Didn't have the ability to do it. Who am I? Guy grew up in Memphis, Tennessee to go try to climb the highest mountain in the world. Now, not even a consideration. A few days later, we're back down and we're trekking over to one of the villages outside of Namche, one of our, our Siddhar. We went to his home there and I'm going to spend the night. And I'm walking along with David and Dave looks over at me with that wonderful Australian accent, which I'm not even going to pretend like I could. New Zealand. I apologize profusely. He's New Zealander, not Australian. So political error there, right? So, the Kiwi looked at me and he just said, "So mate, you did well on Ama. Now it's time for Everest." And with that, the seed was planted. I looked back at him and I don't think I said much. And so we kept on walking pretty much in silence. And pretty soon I started to think more and more about it. And so I began to lay the groundwork for it. So I came back to the U.S. and I trained really hard. I trained on places like the Grand Teton, of course, my Colorado 14ers, over when I was living in Switzerland, a lot of Mont Blanc, just really trying to get those mountain skills honed. And I went and I did my first attempt on Mount Everest in 2002. That's a story for another time. Obviously, I did not make that summit. I did summit finally in 2011, and that's put the summit certificate back here over my shoulder. That's that summit certificate with Kami Sherpa, whom I'm forever indebted to, my guardian angel in the mountains. And in fact, he's guiding again this year with Mike Hamill's Climbing the Seven Summits. And one of my summit coach clients just sent me a picture of him with Kami. It was so great to see him. Okay, so that's it for today, Wednesday, April the 6th. We'll do another podcast probably this weekend on the weekend update. By then, we'll have a better idea of what's going on with the permits and how many people are going to be climbing this year. But for now, that's all. Climb on. This is Alan. And remember, memories are everything.